ARDS, diffuse alveolar damage, DAD, shock lung, or hyaline membrane disease. Definition. Acute respiratory distress syndrome is an acute, diffuse, inflammatory form of lung injury that is associated with a variety of etiologies. Respiratory failure occurring within a week of a known clinical insult with bilateral opacities on chest imaging, not fully explained by effusions, atelectasis, cardiac failure, or fluid overload. Acute respiratory distress syndrome happens when inflammation causes diffuse alveolar injury or damage, diffuse alveolar necrosis, pulmonary edema, infiltrates, and hyaline membrane formation. Non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema resulting from acute alveolar to capillary damage. Sepsis and pneumonia are the most common causes. It is graded based on the severity of the changes in arterial blood oxygenation. Note, acute lung injury, ALI, also called non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, is characterized by the abrupt onset of significant hypoxemia and bilateral pulmonary infiltrates in the absence of cardiac failure. This terminology is going out of use as ARDS is seen as a manifestation of severe ALI. The newer definitions include ARDS as a separate entity and ALI is not being used. Both ARDS and ALI are associated with inflammation-associated increases in pulmonary vascular permeability, edema, and epithelial cell death. The causes. It's caused by direct injury to the lungs or systemic diseases. Infection, such as sepsis, diffuse pulmonary infections by viral, mycoplasma, pneumocystis pneumonia, or miliary tuberculosis, and gastric aspiration can all cause ARDS. Physical injury, such as mechanical trauma, including head injuries, pulmonary contusions, near drowning, fractures with fat embolism, burns, and ionizing radiation can also cause ARDS. Inhaled irritants, such as oxygen toxicity, smoke, irritant gases and chemicals, as well as chemical injury by heroin or methadone overdose, acetyl salicylic acid, barbiturate overdose, or paraquat can cause ARDS. Hematologic conditions, including TRALI, which is transfusion-associated lung injury, and disseminated intravascular coagulation, DIC, or disseminated intravascular coagulation can also cause ARDS. Pancreatitis, uremia, cardiopulmonary bypass, and hypersensitivity reactions to organic solvents or drugs can cause ARDS. Note, more than 50% of the cases of acute respiratory distress syndrome are associated with the four conditions of sepsis, diffuse pulmonary infections, gastric aspirations, and mechanical trauma including head injuries. The causes are diverse. The shared feature is that all lead to extensive bilateral injury to the alveoli. Idiopathic ARDS is known as Hammond-Rich syndrome. Acute interstitial pneumonia. This is widespread acute lung injury of unknown etiology associated with a rapidly progressive clinical course. It is sometimes referred to as ALI-DAD. It's an uncommon disorder that occurs at a mean age of 59 years and has no sex predilection. Patients present with acute respiratory failure, often following an illness of less than 3 weeks duration that resembles an upper respiratory tract infection. The radiographic and pathologic features are identical to those of the organizing stage of ALI. The mortality rate is high and varies from 33% to 74%, with most deaths occurring within 1 to 2 months. Recurrences and chronic interstitial lung disease may occur in the survivors. Causes accounting for more than 50% of the cases included trauma, shock, gastric aspiration, and diffuse pulmonary infection. Capillary damage leads to exudation of inflammatory cells, polymorphonuclear cells or PMNs, macrophages, RBCs, and protein into the interstitium. There is formation of an intraalveolar hyaline membrane. Neutrophils cause destruction of type 1 and type 2 pneumocytes, which triggers a loss of surfactant and then leads to atelectasis. This causes the formation of an intrapulmonary shunt, a VQ mismatch with no ventilation. Pathogenesis of ARDS. Capillary endothelial damage plays a major role in the pathogenesis of ARDS and is the most important step. A tabular formulation of this mechanism includes sepsis, diffuse pulmonary infections, gastric aspiration, mechanical trauma, all cause a direct release from the circulation or an indirect release by resident alveolar macrophages secondary to pneumocyte injury of cytokines. These include TNF and IL-1. This leads to, (1) pulmonary endothelial damage, (2) pulmonary endothelial activation. This then triggers the activated endothelial cells to express adhesion molecules, procoagulant proteins, and chemokines. This then leads to adhesion and extravasation of neutrophils into the interstitium and alveoli. Neutrophils degranulate and release inflammatory mediators. The proteases that release digest proteins, reactive oxygen species cause free radical damage, cytokines perpetuate the inflammation, and macrophage migration inhibitory factor, MIF, sustains the ongoing pro-inflammatory response. These four mechanisms then again trigger pulmonary endothelial damage and pulmonary endothelial activation, and the cycle continues. Once these have been released, they trigger increased recruitment and adhesion of leukocytes. This mechanism then leads to three conditions. There is more endothelial damage, there is pneumocyte damage, or local thrombosis. When you have more endothelial damage, the pulmonary capillaries get leaky, and interstitial and alveolar edema occurs, and this interstitial and alveolar edema can be picked up as infiltrates on a chest x-ray and also causes dyspnea. This ultimately leads to reduced ventilation with normal perfusion, and there is a ventilation-perfusion mismatch. The second mechanism leading to pneumocyte damage causes less gas exchange, which damage to type 1 cells, and less surfactant, which damage to type 2 cells. Both of these then lead to alveolar collapse, which also causes a VQ mismatch. And there is also inspissated protein-rich edema fluid and necrotic cell debris which organize. And these cause the hyaline membrane to form, and this again triggers the ventilation-perfusion mismatch to reduce ventilation and normal perfusion. This ultimately leads to intrapulmonary shunting, which triggers hypoxemia, causing cyanosis and ultimately respiratory failure. In ARDS, which happens beyond 7 days, the inflammatory stimulus slowly lessens. This happens because the macrophages remove cellular debris. They also release fibrogenic cytokines such as transforming growth factor beta, TGF-beta, and PDGF, a platelet-derived growth factor. This then triggers fibroblast growth, collagen deposition, ultimately leading to fibrosis of the alveolar wall. The bronchiolar stem cells proliferate to replace the pneumocytes, and uninjured capillary endothelium proliferates to restore the endothelium. This triggers resolution of the ARDS finally. Morphology. DAD, or diffuse alveolar damage, is a characteristic histological manifestation of ARDS. In the acute stage, the lungs are heavy, firm, red, and boggy. They exhibit congestion, interstitial and intraalveolar edema, inflammation, fibrin deposition, and diffuse alveolar damage, or DAD. The alveolar walls become lines with waxy hyaline membranes. Alveolar hyaline membranes are eosinophilic and glassy and consist of fibrin-rich edema fluid mixed with cytoplasmic and lipid remnants of necrotic epithelial cells. Hyaline membranes appear by the second day and are the most conspicuous morphologic feature of the exudative phase after 4 to 5 days. In the organizing stage, type 2 pneumocytes proliferate vigorously in an attempt to regenerate the alveolar lining, and granulation tissue forms in the alveolar walls and spaces. In most cases, the granulation tissue resolves, leaving minimal functional impairment. Sometimes, however, fibrotic thickening or scarring of the alveolar septa ensues. Fatal cases often have superimposed bronchopneumonia. The clinical course. There are three phases in the natural history: exudative phase, proliferative phase, and a fibrotic phase. In the exudative phase, there is a characterization by alveolar edema and neutrophil inflammation, with subsequent development of hyaline membranes, which are eosinophilic and glassy, and they cause the diffuse alveolar damage. The alveolar edema, which is the most prominent in the dependent portions of the lung, causes atelectasis and reduced lung compliance. The duration of this phase is typically up to 7 days in length and usually begins within 12 to 36 hours after the inciting insult. Hypoxemia or cyanosis, tachypnea, and progressive dyspnea develop, and increased pulmonary dead space can also lead to hypercapnia or hypercarbia. Late inspiratory crackles can be heard on auscultation. Respiratory failure frequently develops during this phase. A chest x-ray reveals bilateral, diffuse alveolar and interstitial opacities. Common differential diagnosis includes cardiogenic pulmonary edema, pneumonia, and alveolar hemorrhage. Unlike cardiogenic pulmonary edema, the chest x-ray in ARDS rarely shows cardiomegaly, pleural effusions, or pulmonary vascular redistribution. The second phase, the proliferative phase, this phase typically lasts from approximately day 7 to 21 after the inciting insult. Interstitial inflammation and proliferative type 2 pneumocytes persist, but hyaline membranes are no longer formed. Alveolar macrophages digest the remnants of the hyaline membranes and other debris. Although most patients recover, some will develop progressive lung injury and evidence of pulmonary fibrosis. Even among patients who show rapid improvement allowing removal of mechanical ventilator support, dyspnea and hypoxemia often persist during this phase. In the third and final phase, the fibrotic phase, most patients recover within 3 to 4 weeks of the initial pulmonary injury, but some experience progressive fibrosis necessitating prolonged ventilator support and or supplemental oxygen. There's an increased risk of pneumothorax, reductions in lung compliance, and increased pulmonary dead space observed during this phase. Remodeling of lung architecture produces many cyst-like spaces throughout the lung, or a honeycomb lung. These spaces are separated by thick fibrous walls lined by type 2 pneumocytes, bronchiolar epithelium, or squamous cells. Clinical features. Patients destined to develop ARDS have a symptom-free interval for a few hours after the initial insult. Tachypnea and dyspnea mark the onset of ARDS. Bilateral Krebs and bibasilar crackles are heard on auscultation. Blood gas analysis shows arterial hypoxemia and decreased PCO2. As ARDS progresses, dyspnea worsens and the patient becomes cyanotic. Diffuse bilateral interstitial and alveolar infiltrates are noted radiologically. Increased inspired oxygen concentration does not restore adequate blood oxygenation, necessitating mechanical ventilation. In fatal cases, the combination of increasing tachypnea and decreasing tidal volume causes alveolar hypoventilation, progressive hypoxemia, and increasing PCO2. Patients who survive ARDS may recover normal pulmonary function, but in severe cases, they are left with scarred lungs, respiratory dysfunction, and in some instances, pulmonary hypertension. Note: severe ARDS is characterized by a rapid onset of life-threatening respiratory insufficiency, cyanosis, and severe arterial hypoxemia that is refractory to oxygen therapy. Diagnosis. 4 key criteria for the diagnosis of RDS include: number 1, acute onset, respiratory failure occurring within 1 week of a known clinical insult; number 2, diffuse bilateral pulmonary infiltrates on chest x-ray; and progression to widespread alveolar consolidation with air bronchograms, which is 80%; number 3, a PaO2, or arterial partial pressure of oxygen millimeter mercury, divided by FiO2, or inspired oxygen fraction, less than or equal to 200 millimeters of mercury, which is severe hypoxemia not responsive to oxygen therapy; and the 4th criteria is absence of elevated left atrial pressure or pulmonary capillary wedge pressure less than or equal to 18 millimeters of mercury. It's important to distinguish ARDS from cardiogenic pulmonary edema, in which the pulmonary artery wedge pressure is more than 18 millimeters of mercury. The newer criteria for diagnosis of acute respiratory distress syndrome have removed the elevated left atrial pressure, and they have also included the ability to use a non-invasive ventilation with a measure of PEEP. Other findings in this condition include respiratory acidosis or normal PaCO2. There's an increased alveolar arterial gradient caused by intrapulmonary shunting related to atelectasis and diffusion abnormalities related to hyaline membranes and an alveolar infiltrate. FiO2 is a fraction of the amount of oxygen a person is inhaling. For example, in room air, it's 0.21. A nasal cannula can be 0.24 to 0.44. A venturi mass can be 0.24 to 0.5. Treatment. General critical care of patients with ARDS in addition to lung protective ventilator strategies. General care includes treatment of the underlying medical or surgical problem that caused the lung injury, minimizing iatrogenic complications, prophylaxis to prevent venous thromboembolism and GI hemorrhage, prompt treatment of nosocomial infections, and adequate nutritional support. Patients with ARDS need mechanical ventilator support due to hypoxemia and increased work of breathing. Low tidal volumes are combined with the use of positive end expiratory pressure, or PEEP, at levels that strive to minimize alveolar collapse and achieve adequate oxygenation with the lowest required FiO2. Initial management of ARDS. To initiate volume of pressure-limited ventilation, and the goals and limits include a tidal volume less than or equal to 6 mL per kilogram predicted body weight, keeping a plateau pressure less than or equal to 30 cm of water, and a respiratory rate less than or equal to 35 breaths per minute. You have to oxygenate, and FiO2 should be kept below or equal to 0.6 or 60%, a PEEP or a positive end expiratory pressure less than or equal to 10 cm of water, and maintain a saturation of 88 to 95%. The PEEP can be higher depending on the status of the ARDS. Then you have to minimize the acidosis and keep the pH above 7.3 and a respiratory rate less than or equal to 35 breaths per minute. Then there should be some diuresis to maintain a MAP more than 65 mm of mercury and avoiding hyperperfusion. You can also have a concept called permissive hypercapnia where you allow the PCO2 to go up. Ancillary therapies include IV fluid administration only as needed to achieve adequate cardiac output and tissue oxygen delivery as assessed by the urine output, the acid-base status, and arterial pressure. There is increased pulmonary vascular permeability leading to interstitial and alveolar edema in ARDS, so you have to be cautious with IV fluid administration. Neuromuscular blockage with cis-atracurium for 48 hours potentially can reduce the mortality in severe ARDS. The prognosis is poor. 40 to 50% of mortality rate in ARDS can vary depending on the underlying etiology and supportive care. The mortality rate does increase with age. The differential diagnosis for ARDS includes pulmonary edema from heart failure, which can be diagnosed by left atrial hypertension and changes on an echocardiogram. You can have chronic interstitial lung disease. This usually will not be acute in presentation, but will have a more gradual, indolent course and prior radiographic findings. Hypersensitivity pneumonitis. Hypersensitivity pneumonitis can be in the clinical context of a recent inhalation, although not as severe, it can progress to ARDS. Diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. Bronchoscopy will show progressively more blood-tinged Lavage samples. Acute interstitial pneumonia. This will resemble ARDS both radiographically and clinically, but without an obvious cause or risk. Histopathology will show diffuse alveolar damage on lung biopsy. Some patients will benefit from steroids. This should be considered when ARDS does not improve despite aggressive treatment. There are some imaging studies shown. So, number one, a single portable semi-upright AP to the chest. The initial chest radiograph obtained at the time of the patient's presentation demonstrating no significant abnormalities except for low lung volumes. If you then have another X-ray as the disease progresses, the portable recumbent APU of the chest shows the second radiograph, which was obtained 8 hours after the first one, showing diffuse bilateral airspace opacities, left more than right, which you can see the straight black arrows, and in the left hemithorax with fewer airspace opacities, which are obscuring the periphery of the lung, there's no convincing evidence of any curly B lines of pleural thickening, which may be expected in hydrostatic pulmonary edema. As time progresses, the single X-ray, which is recumbent in the APU, shows in about 3 to 4 days after the initial presentation, internal improvement in the left lung airspace opacities, but there's a suggestion that there's resolution of the initial insult. However, there has been development of coalescent bivasal opacities, especially in the left, with an increasing gradation of the density towards the lung bases, suggesting pleural effusions, which can be seen with the white arrows. There is now evidence of pleural thickening on the right. These findings reflect perhaps improving ARDS and the development of pulmonary edema as a result of aggressive IV hydration and fluid overload. If you were to get a CT scan, such as an axial non-contrast CT, and you can see in the upper lung windows and in the upper lungs, there is some evidence of patchy airspace and ground glass opacities bilaterally, which are seen in the straight black arrows. Left is more so than the right, with concomitant dense consolidation of the dependent lung, which is seen in the straight white arrows. There is no significant peribronchial thickening and only minimal interlobular septal thickening. The findings of pleural fluid are most likely related to aggressive IV hydration and fluid overload and reflect superimposed hydrostatic edema. Number 5. Axial non-contrast CT image of the chest viewed in the lung windows and the middle lungs. Patchy airspace and ground glass opacities are evident bilaterally, straight black arrows, left more so than the right, with concomitant dense consolidation in the dependent lung. You can see that with the straight white arrows. There is no significant peribronchial thickening and only minimal interlobular septal thickening. The findings of pleural fluid are most likely related to aggressive IV hydration and fluid overload and reflect superimposed hydrostatic edema. Number 6. Axial non-contrast CT image of the chest viewed in lung windows and lower lungs. Patchy airspace and ground glass opacities are evident bilaterally, straight black arrows, left more so than the right, with concomitant dense consolidation of the dependent lung, shown by the straight white arrows. There is no significant peribronchial thickening and only minimal interlobular septal thickening. The findings of pleural fluid are most likely related to aggressive high-vitality hydration and fluid overload reflex superimposed hydrostatic edema. Number 7, a sagittal non-contrast CT image of the chest viewed in soft tissue windows to the right lung. Patchy airspace and ground gas opacities are evident bilaterally, left more so than the right, with concomitant dense consolidation of the dependent lung. There is no significant peribronchial thickening, and only minimal interlobular septal thickening. The findings of pleural fluid are most likely related to aggressive IV hydration and fluid overload and reflect superimposed hydrostatic edema. Finally, a coronal non-contrast CT image of the chest viewed in the lung windows through the lungs. The patchy airspace and ground gas opacities are evident bilaterally, straight black arrows, left more so than the right, with concomitant dense consolidation of the dependent lung, the straight white arrow. There is no significant peribronchial thickening, and only minimal interlobular septal thickening. The findings of pleural fluid are most likely related to aggressive IV hydration and fluid overload, and reflect superimposed hydrostatic edema.